Recorded Books presents The Surviving Sky by Kritika H. Rao. Narrated by Sharmila Devar and Pranshu Mishra.
1. Ahilya. The bracken didn't react to Ahilya as it should have. She tried again, drawing her desire for the leaves to part to a single point. Open. I want to see. It was unnatural, eerie almost, how defiant the plants were. It was as if her limbs refused to move despite the command of her mind. She stood alone on a wide curving terrace of her airborne city, Nuxur. An hour earlier, a dozen citizens had flocked to the promenade, seeking a final look at the open skies before Nuxur landed in the jungle. Ahilya had yearned for solitude, unwilling to conduct her study in front of them. But now she gazed at the empty bark benches, the shady trees, the soft moss floor. Everything looked the same. Then why did the bracken wall behave so differently? It had been waist-high earlier, a mere parapet. But now it towered over her, growing rapidly. Tendrils curled into tight, thorny balls. Branches squeezed together, twisting in intricate lattices. The entire structure hardened as though to deny her. And none of it responded to her desire to see beyond the city. Ahilya jogged alongside the wall until she found a small gap in the leafy growth. There, below thick clouds within a twilight sky, waited the earth's surface. She unslung the satchel from her shoulder. Eyes on the gap, she rummaged until she found her telescope, then dropped the bag gently by her feet. Ahilya pressed the telescope to her face so hard, it pinched her skin. The image focused just in time for her to see another dust explosion. Her breath quickened. There was a pattern to the dust, a shift she had theorized once. For the first time, she was viewing the epicenter of the fading storm. Her hands itched to take her tablet and stylus from the satchel to draw the patterns, but there was no time. The leaves on the city's wall were morphing too fast. She'd just have to commit the explosion to memory. Dark green shuttered her vision. Ahilya lowered her telescope and peered through the foliage, but the wall was relentless again. "Come on," she muttered. "What is wrong with you? Open up a little bit, at least."
"Naksha's plants won't respond to non-architects anymore,"
an amused voice called out. Ahilya spun around. Nayla stepped off an ascending wooden pedestal that had emerged from a hole in the floor. She was dressed in her architect's uniform, an embroidered green kurta reaching her knees, flared over narrow pleated trousers. Her long translucent robe wafted in the breeze. Thick black beads looped around Nayla's neck. More beads, bracelets and rings, clinked around her wrists and fingers, held together by thin, glassy optical fibers. The junior architect was perhaps 25, nearly a decade younger than Ahilya, but the Rudra beads indicated more responsibility for their flying city than Ahilya would ever be granted. All Ahilya owned was her obligatory citizen ring.
"Ordinary citizens no longer have any control over the architecture,"
Nayla repeated, striding forward. Ahilya forced a smile. "Great, you're here. I think I saw something. This incredible pattern of dust that might reveal the source of the instability down there. Will you open the wall for me? I want to sketch it."
"You want to draw dust?"
"I want to draw dust during landing," Ahilya corrected. "It's the best way to understand earthrages."
"Oh, I can explain those to you,"
Nayla said, flicking a lock of dark hair behind her.
They're cataclysmic storms.
Yes, thank you. I'm trying to understand why they happen at all.
Because of a disruption of consciousness.
No, I meant, why did earthrages begin in the first place?
They've been around as long as we have.
How did...
Really, Ahilya?
The junior architect said, sniffing.
These questions have already been answered. And these dust patterns you want to draw, the architects have studied those for years.
Ahilya turned back to the wall. She had asked the architects for their drawings, but they had summarily rejected her requests, citing their records as privileged architect information, a slap on the face she had never received before. Right, fine, thanks for that, she said. Could you open this, please? I might still be able to get a few rough sketches.
I can't.
Sure you can. You're an architect, aren't you? The plants literally shift at your behest. Nayla gave her an unimpressed look.
That's very reductive. How can you be married to a senior architect and not know the intricacies of trajection?
We try not to talk about it, lest we begin arguing about how we see the world, Ahilya said. Her voice remained mild. The workings of plant manipulation had always been too esoteric for her, but the truth was that, ever since her husband had been promoted to the council, the two had stopped talking about each other's pursuits altogether. Her fingers scrabbled at the leaves.
Please, you don't have to open it all. Just enough for me to see. I can't,
Nayla said, exasperated, as though dealing with a child.
Now that there's finally another lull in the earthrages, and now that we're finally landing, the temple architects have enforced higher limits on the architecture. That's why non-architects don't have any control.
But you're...
Yes, I know, but I'm a junior architect. Anything that doesn't align with the temple's guidance is almost impossible to do, especially by me. And they're closing the city. Look around you. I'd be trying to fly against a windstream.
Ahilya released her hold on the wall. Loose leaves glided down onto the moss floor. But the floor wasn't moss anymore. It was transforming into bark. The benches and trees were gone. From all sides, thorny bushes rushed toward them, eating the curve of the terrace in their hungry approach. Even the bracken wall had extended, entrapping the terrace in a dome. Leaves and stems crisscrossed in 100 different layers as the foliage tightened. Darkness would fall in seconds. Ahilya's brows furrowed. Nuxar had always been a flat city flying in the sky. Its architect formed hills, with massive trees that housed the library and schools and homes, usually spanned acres. Checkered fields grew on the edges, and rainwater was harvested in rocky pools and waterfalls. She had never heard of the architecture changing so completely.
Relax, Nayla said. The council will release permissions beyond the temple again as soon as we land. Non-architects will be able to mold the architecture, and this part of the terrace will transform into an entry point close to the jungle. Shouldn't affect your expedition.
Ahilya frowned and stepped away from the wall, the dust patterns she'd wanted to study forgotten. There was something in Nayla's casual words, a message she did not understand. She glanced at the unresponsive architecture, studied Nayla's insouciant stance, thought about the easy assurances. A prickle of worry climbed the back of her neck. She had lived in Nuxar all her life, but matters in the city had been changing recently. Hardly anyone paid attention, but Ahilya had kept track. First, it had been the suppression of the architect's records. Then the fight to get her expedition approved. Now this? Control was being taken away from the citizens slowly and subtly, one way or another. A dangerous pattern. The weight of this realization grew, pressing her shoulders down. In the end, wasn't that what life in the flying cities was really about? The lack of autonomy she and others like her had over their own lives? Ahilya's expedition, her dealings with Druv, the vacant council seat she was eyeing, everything she had done all her life was to balance this inequity, but things were coming to a head now. She could feel it. She cleared her throat and returned her attention to Nela.
Why was the design changed? I told you, they've enforced higher limits.
Yes, but why? The junior architect tilted her head and studied her for a long second. Then she smiled.
For architect's reasons, she said coolly. Why does a historian care to go into the jungle?
She added, asking her own question.
Aren't there detailed accounts of our histories in the libraries?
Ahilya flinched. The questions were calculated insults. Nela knew Ahilya was an archaeologist, not a historian. She knew any histories of the world were her histories, architect histories. She knew why Ahilya explored the jungle. Life had begun there, and Ahilya's entire research was to find a way to return to it again, to find survival on land instead of in architect-dependent cities in the sky. This was a deliberate attempt to bait her. Either that, or Nela had learned nothing from the documents Ahilya had provided to prepare for the expedition. It was likely beneath the junior architect to take any instruction from a non-architect. Refusing to indulge either attempt to shame her, Ahilya snapped the telescope shut and dropped to her knees to place it back into her satchel.
If only they would tell her.
Nela had mentioned the recent earthrage as a reason behind this new design, and based on that alone, Ahilya could have helped the architects, shared information about what she discovered, even studied something for them. But she was a non-architect, a pretender. What use was an archaeologist in a civilization that had only ever known flight? Ahilya had practically invented the term. They were not going to tell her anything. The junior architect was simply reminding her of her place. Ahilya pushed aside her strain with an effort, closed her satchel, and rose to her feet. In the few seconds it had taken her to repack her instrument, the terrace had closed entirely so that she and Nela stood face to face on a square of bark. Thorny bushes enveloped them from all sides, obscuring any view. So, where are Druv and Om? Ahilya asked, referring to the other two members of her team. Nela tilted her head.
They're in the temple, with the rest of the citizens.
Why? I told them to assemble here.
Iravanve. He insisted the temple was the safest place until Nakshar had fully landed.
The respectful suffix attached to her husband as an architect, but never to Ahilya as an archaeologist, grated on Ahilya. Her hand curled tightly around her satchel. Iravan had abandoned her for 7 months, and now he thought to give orders to her team without her knowledge? All of her restrained irritation bubbled up, tightening her throat.
And they listened, she said. Even Om? Om tried to protest, saying you needed us here. And Druv, well, I don't think Druv wanted to go toe-to-toe with a counselor.
Om was only as old as Nela. Iravan would have intimidated the boy with a glance. As for Druv, ever since his last few inventions had failed, the Sungeneer had become wary of disturbing the council. Ahilya's closest friend he might be, but Druv wouldn't openly oppose senior architect Iravan.
I see,
she said. Iravan Ve requested you go to the temple too. That's why I'm here. I'm supposed to bring you there.
Bring me?
Escort you, Nayla said. Request you. He didn't demand it.
But he might as well have, Ahilya completed, her teeth gritted.
Nayla shook her head in furious protest.
No, no, not like that. It's a matter of safety. No one should be out here.
Ahilya remained rooted. The dome above was a mere hand breadth away now. Sharp pointed leaves reached so low, they tickled her ears. But the instant they made contact with her skin, the pinpoints shed themselves. Instead, the stem budded softer leaves. Ahilya smelt the warm, sticky sap of regeneration. If she didn't move soon, she'd be entombed in a layer of foliage. Nuxture's living architecture would sheathe her in her own personal wooden armor. That had been Ahilya's plan, for her and her expeditionary team.
Rage, Iravan, and his raging interference. I'm staying here, she said, voice cool. You can tell Iravan Ve that.
Nayla extended a robe-covered arm upward toward their cocoon. Her skin, like Ahilya's and most natives of Nuxture, was terracotta brown. Nayla's veins, however, began to glow an iridescent green as she influenced the vegetation around them. 1,000 tattooed vines and creepers grew on her arms underneath the translucent sleeves of her uniform's robe. Some of the leaves touching Ahilya retracted.
Please, that is really not wise.
The condescension had left Nayla.
I know this design. It's ellipsoidal, like a sunflower seed. We're in the outermost shell. This is where the greatest impact will be. That's why everyone was asked, requested to the temple, to Nuxture's core. You received the instruction through your citizen ring too, didn't you? I know you did.
Ahilya rubbed a thumb over her single Rudra bead. It flashed and rang a few hours ago, but I know the city will provide an alternative.
At great cost. The architects in the temple will have to divert unnecessary trajection to keep you safe here. You're risking the reliability of the entire construction. Nuxture could crash into the jungle instead of landing safely.
Nayla jingled the Rudra beads on her wrist as though to emphasize the burden of her responsibility. Her words and actions were typical architect manipulation. But Ahilya had spent more than a decade married to a senior architect.
Is that really true, Nayla?
She asked quietly.
Because I asked the temple about this. I was told I could wait here. That was before Iravan Ve altered the landing design. Your old permissions don't apply anymore.
Ahilya clutched her satchel.
Of course.
She should have guessed Iravan had been behind the design's change. Still, she could not help the abrupt anger and shock throbbing under her skin. Iravan knew why it was important she leave right away. Without the data from the expedition, Ahilya could forget about being nominated to the council. But of course, he had never fully thought her capable of being a counselor. Was that why he had done this? Because of the vacant council seat? Iravan was on the council, but he had his own plan for the vacancy, one that involved Nayla. She studied the junior architect, the suddenly nervous gestures, the newly feigned concern, the barely veiled contempt. Nayla had sounded logical with her warnings about safety, but there was more there. An undercurrent of unbending dogma lacing her words. Architects were so used to the world submitting to them, they could never see how terrible it was that civilization was designed to be architect-dependent in the first place. Ahilya wouldn't have begrudged it so much right at this very instant if it weren't for everything else with Iravan.
the beginnings of a headache formed behind her eyes at the thought of giving in now, acquiescing to his silent call for obedience. His attempt at maneuvering her was so feeble, it was almost insulting. She felt suddenly tired, outrageously defeated. "You should go," she said. "Go be safe."
"I can't abandon a citizen to potential danger," Nayla said, her voice incensed. "If I leave you, it'll go on my record as endangering Nakshar. I'm a junior architect. I can't afford transgressions."
"Nice try," Ahilya shot back. "I know you're well on your way to becoming a senior architect one day. Wasn't that the real reason Iravan gave you a key to accompany my expedition? To add the jungle to your field of experiences so he can nominate you to the council. I hardly think he'll hold you accountable for my stubbornness." True to her profession, Nayla switched tactics at once.
"Well, then consider. I can't disobey a senior architect. If you don't come with me, Ravinve will question me, perhaps even forbid me from accompanying the expedition altogether. And then where will you be? No architect, no expedition, remember?"
Ahilya stared at her. "They teach you how to influence people as an architect too?" Nayla smiled, a tightness to her mouth.
"No, we gather that on our own. Can't maneuver anything beyond a plant, but I suppose the principles of trajection remain the same."
Against her will, Ahilya felt a strange, morbid amusement. It was almost impressive how skilled Nayla was. None of the other junior architects the council had provided to her for previous expeditions had displayed such an effective change of strategy so quickly. No wonder Iravan had picked her to be his protege. In Nayla's quick thinking and casual arrogance, Ahilya detected glimmers of Aravan's own personality. She sighed and clutched her satchel close to her. Her nod was curt.
"Hold on," Nayla murmured.
She closed her eyes and opened her palms in front of her. Her veins flared again, the iridescence making Ahilya's eyes water. A dozen dizzying patterns of vines formed and died on the architect's skin. For a long moment, they remained motionless.
"Well," Ahilya said, "are we going?"
"We are going,"
Nayla said, cracking open an eye.
"We're descending. Can't you tell?"
Ahilya blinked. Their little nest looked no different. The canopy was still touching their heads, thorns on all sides, no wind of passage. Were they falling downward toward the city's core? Or was Nayla changing the plants around them, outside of their nest? Perhaps the nest wasn't passing through a tunnel. It was destroying and reconstructing itself, using the plants of the city to undulate them through the architecture. Ahilya's head spun. Contrary to what she had said to the junior architect, she did know some things about trajection. The power was inborn. It could not be learned. Even though under ordinary circumstances, Ahilya could ask the city's plants to react to her desires, that was a charity provided by the architects who allowed their energy to flow through the foliage for the citizens to use. Ahilya had no true control. Only architects could directly influence a plant's consciousness, forcing it to change form. Yet for Nayla to do it this way, in such an invisible manner. Either the junior architect was more skilled than Ahilya had credited her with, or the architects had learned new tricks in the time since Ahilya and Iravan had held a proper conversation.
"How are you doing this?"
she began. The nest jerked. Ahilya's knees buckled.
"Sorry," Nayla panted, steadying her. "Rougher than I intended. Trajecting is harder outside the temple, this close to the landing."
"I suppose You could have brought me with you without waiting for my permission, and I wouldn't have known, Ahilya said reluctantly.
Nayla threw her another amused look.
Architects aren't tyrants. This way.
Her fingers twitched, a waving gesture. The leaves in front of them separated to reveal a small courtyard. They stepped through, and new bark closed behind them. In the distance, vast tree trunks collapsed as though crushed by a giant hand. Foliage folded into itself, then tightened into stony bark. What had once been apartment complexes in trees, schools and playgrounds and homes, all changed as Nuxur coiled in on itself. When Ahilya glanced behind, bark chased her footsteps. Small florets became hard seeds. Supple ferns developed rough calluses. Needles and cones grew where a moment earlier there had been languorous sprays. The courtyard morphed in front of her eyes. She had no idea where she was. Nuxur's architecture was called a maze for a reason. Even in ordinary flight, everything except for the city's fixed landmarks grew and changed. A path was provided for citizens by the trajectory coursing through the plants. Except Ahilya no longer had any influence over the architecture. She hurried after Nayla's blue-green light. It was one thing to be cocooned on a terrace that would become the best entry point to the jungle, entirely another to be encased within an unknown layer of the city. Sweat coated her upper lip at the thought of how little power she had. She had lost measure of how much distance they'd covered when they reached another wall and Nayla's iridescence flared again. The wooden wall transformed into a doorway. They stepped into a narrow, shadowy passageway. Bark closed behind them. Nayla slowed, her breath releasing in a huff. The junior architect grinned and gestured for Ahilya to precede her. First came the scent, the rich, heady smell of moist earth. Then the lilting sounds of excitement and laughter. Tiny, sun-generating glow globes, like stars trapped in plants, emerged from the foliage to guide Ahilya's way as she strode farther in. Ahilya squinted as her eyes adjusted to the swelling brightness. A narrow archway beckoned at the end of the passageway, from where tiny white buds hung down in curtains. Ahilya's breath caught in her throat. Jasmine was her favorite. Could that be Raven's doing somehow? But no, not after the way they had left things the last time together. Not if his punishing silence were any indication of his feelings. She was being foolish. For a long moment, Ahilya hesitated, staring at the jasmine. Her heart hammered in her chest. She recalled his expression, how he'd walked away from her, how angry he'd been. All the dread and outrage and confused love she had nursed for 7 long months bubbled within her. Ahilya took a deep breath, parted the fronds, and stepped into the light. 2. Ahilya. She emerged onto a crowded, narrow balcony, its wooden railing visible beyond congregating bodies. Most citizens were standing, but interspersed were heel-branched chairs, specially made for those who needed them. Behind Ahilya, the archway transformed into bark in a telltale creak. Nayla had deposited her in a gallery full of familiar faces, but hardly anyone noticed Ahilya's arrival. The junior architect had disappeared, likely to fulfill her role in the landing. Ahilya began to pick her way through the crowd, murmuring greetings to the families of other architects. Vihanen waved at her, a man with alluvial dark skin like Iravan's, indigenous to the city of Yikshar. Renya smiled, her toddler clutching her sari with a chubby fist.
The woman's eyes ran down Ahilya's clothing, then grew wide. They were dressed in their finest kurtas and saris, no doubt in anticipation of greeting their architect spouses who had been on shift in the temple. Ahilya's attire, a harness over a kurta and tapered trousers, stuck out like a weed in a tulip field. With a headlamp perched over her hair and a compass around her wrist instead of bangles, she was more suited to an expedition in the jungle than a long-awaited landing. Ahilya pasted a smile on her face, avoided their gazes, and wove her way through the crowd. Most of them had grown up in Nakshar with her, but over the years, all had devolved into mere acquaintances. Her own fault, of course. Her pursuits had made her an oddity. Ahilya swallowed her rising shame and averted her eyes to the rest of the temple, visible through the gaps in the bodies. The temple was oval-shaped, with 50 balconies circling from the floor to the ceiling, each full of chattering citizens. At the very center rose the Rudra tree. The trunk mushroomed as wide as 20 people standing shoulder to shoulder. Countless aerial roots, like slender branches, hung down to the floor. Iravan had often remarked on how Nakshar's core tree was worth years of study, and for a moment, Ahilya agreed. Ethereal blue-green light flickered and gleamed in the top stories, making the tree appear mystical. She squeezed through the crowd until she found her sister, Tharia, fidgeting on her chair, right by the gnarled railing of the gallery. "Finally," Tharia said. "Where have you been?" Ahilya's older sister was shorter than her and beautiful. Her raven-black hair tumbled down her shoulders in glossy curls. Her skin, though the same brown as Ahilya's, seemed to glow. Her big, coal-lined eyes were shining with happiness. Tharia shifted restlessly on her seat, her baby asleep in her arms. "Here, hold him," she said. Ahilya found Arth thrust toward her. Her nephew's weight was awkward. She squirmed, trying to ease the position, shifting her elbow, then her shoulders.
"I can take him,"
a soft voice said. Tharia's older son, Kush, edged through the press, gathered Arth, then returned to where the other children stood together in a rumble of noise. Tharia called out a caution, then glanced up at Ahilya.
"What took you?" she asked.
"Can you believe it? The ashram is finally landing."
She straightened the pleats of her sari around her waist and readjusted the bindi on her forehead. Nakshar, maze, city. There were many words to describe the airborne structure in which they lived, but none was as pretentious as ashram. The term meant a hermitage, but the architects had appropriated it to imply more. The city's community, its people, a shared sense of purpose. Ahilya had once found it charming, but over the years it had become just another architect manipulation. She had stopped using the term altogether, her arguments with Tharia about it another point of difference between them. Yet Tharia looked so radiant this evening, her happiness rare and precious. Now was not the time to correct her.
"You look lovely as ever," Ahilya said instead, smiling. "Baravi won't be able to keep her eyes off you."
"She had better not. I've something in mind for the two of us to do every day, for as long as this lull lasts."
Tharia finished adjusting her sari and reached up to give Ahilya a hug, but stopped as though only now noticing her. Her sister groaned and unfastened Ahilya's wrist compass, uncaring of the fragility of the instrument.
"Really, Ahilya, does Iravan like you looking like this?"
Ahilya caught Tharia's hands before she could do more damage. "I like me looking like this."
"But don't you know what landing means?" I finally get to go into the jungle for my expedition.
Your architect husband gets to be off duty. You get uninterrupted time with him. You don't have to be stuck in the library anymore, studying something obscure.
I'm sure we'll see each other once I'm back, Ahilya said. Her irritation bubbled close to the surface, but she had learned to contain it with Staria. Fighting got them nowhere. Ahilya had to remind herself that it had not always been this way with her sister. Daria's despair had developed ever since their parents had moved away to a different city. It had affected her more than she was willing to admit. Ahilya leaned over the railing, hoping to spot Om or Dhruv, swallowing the scorn in Daria's words. Amongst the 1,000 citizens, it was impossible to discern the only two people who had any faith in her research.
I can't wait to see Baravi, Daria continued. Her last visit was ages ago, and only for a week. The boys miss her. I miss her.
Ahilya drew back. Baravi came to you during the flight?
Of course. Why? Didn't Iravan visit you?
Ahilya shook her head. Each time you said you spoke to her, I assumed it was through the ring. Her finger rubbed her single Rudra bead. Everyone in Nakshar owned a similar bead, provided as a sign of their citizenship. With it, architects could contact the city's population in times of need. With it, citizens could view Nakshar's morphing architecture to know which areas were safe, which under construction. Over the years, the citizen ring had been embedded with several permissions, but it had been created originally for its messaging capabilities, and that was still its primary function.
I didn't realize Baravi actually left the temple to visit, Ahilya said, frowning. Of course she did, several times.
I thought they were both on duty, that they were busy.
They were busy. But Baravi had her breaks, same as Iravan and all the other architects. He didn't visit you even once?
Ahilya shook her head again.
Did you speak to him at least, through your ring?
Ahilya said nothing. Right after the earthrage was announced, she had transmitted a message saying she wanted to reconcile, but Iravan hadn't responded. For 7 months, Ahilya had disconnected every other note she'd composed. She'd spent long nights in her library alcove, burying her pain and confusion in her work, returning home only to sleep, a home where everything reminded her of him. Each time Daria had asked about Iravan, Ahilya had murmured a casual response and changed the subject. How could she explain her marriage to Daria now without betraying herself and Iravan? She knew her husband. This was his way. They had been down this road before, with his angry silences as cutting and eloquent as his words. Daria touched Ahilya's elbow in concern.
Did you two have a fight?
It doesn't matter, Ahilya said.
But
please, Daria, I get enough of this from the rest of Nakshar. All of them watching my marriage, judging my research, whispering about my plans for the city.
Maybe it's time to listen then,
Daria replied, a tone of exasperation entering her voice.
Time to set aside your childish ambitions, especially if it's affecting your marriage. Ahilya, this thing you do, trying to change history? At what cost?
Ahilya jerked her elbow away. The last time she had seen Iravan, spent after their intimacy, they had argued about her childish ambitions, too. Oh, he had been too artistic to frame it like that. He had begun slow, propping himself up on an elbow, his fingers feather soft on her stomach. Ahilya, he'd said. We're ready, don't you think? We've been ready for a while, surely.
Ready,
she'd murmured, too relaxed to probe.
When she could no longer sense his touch, she had opened her eyes to see Iravan sit up. Sunshine danced on his skin, bright, then shadow dark. He ran his hand through his salt and pepper hair.
"I want a child, Ahilya," he said. "Someone to fill this growing chasm inside me."
He laughed bitterly, gazing down at his hand over his heart.
"Don't you feel it? Don't you want one anymore? You did before."
Of course she wanted one. She had always wanted one.
"Why now?"
she asked instead, sitting up. Her heart beat faster. They had avoided speaking of this, knowing it would end in an argument. For him to bring it up now, again, when they'd stolen a moment of peace.
"Why?" he'd asked. "Why not? What are we waiting for? Ahilya, we've been married 11 years.
He reached forward to stroke her hair.
"You can give this to me, to us. If it brings us happiness, why won't you make that choice?"
"Because happiness is not your reason for wanting a child, is it, Iravan? Not really."
His hand had fallen away from her. He'd stared at her as she scrambled for her clothes.
"There's more to this," she said. "This has to do with the demands of the council, with an architect's arbitrary material bonds. Is this about making a child for a child's sake?"
"If making a baby helps convince the others that my commitment to Nakshar is irrevocable, why is that so terrible?"
"I won't make a child to please the council, Iravan. You shouldn't want something so precious for architect reasons."
"Is that what you think? That it's the sole reason I'd want a family? Rages, Ahilya. I want to be a father. Why is that so hard to believe?"
Ahilya fumbled as she began clothing herself, disbelief making her movements inelegant. She had to admire his finesse. He had waited until she was satiated to bring this up.
"Architects and children," she said. "My parents, the way they were with me and Daria, but we weren't born with the ability to traject like them. We were never enough. Her despair because of them. She doesn't admit it, but it worsened. They could never accept."
Iravan cut across her.
"I don't think like them."
"Maybe not right now. But how long before you resent the child for not being like you? Before you're disappointed that it's like me?"
"This is ridiculous," he snapped. "When have I ever indicated you're not my equal?"
"When you started keeping secrets from me,"
she said, rising to anger despite herself.
"When you became a senior architect and counselor. It began 5 years ago, Iravan."
Iravan's voice became hard.
"This isn't about me. This is about you. Everything you do is tied to your resentment because you weren't born with the ability to traject. Your research, your reluctance to have a child. And now you suspect my reason simply because I'm an architect?"
"I'm not an idiot, Iravan. Do you seriously expect me to believe you have no other reasons for wanting a child? No pressures from the council?"
"You're projecting your own insecurities."
"Yes or no?"
Iravan threw his hands up, his rudra beads chinking.
"All architects abide by the directions of the council. If my profession bothers you so much, why did you agree to marry me at all?"
"Because I loved you," she said. "Because you loved me."
"I still do."
"And because you were different from other architects. You didn't think normal citizens any less worthy before. Our ideas of the world were the same. Iravan, you were supposed to do better by us. That was the plan. That's why we worked so hard for you to become a senior architect. So you could change things."
"Rages. I'm still like that. Ahilya.
Are you? She'd asked, sadly, her anger melting all at once into weariness. Then why is it that when there's a council seat available, you're angling to nominate Nela, a junior architect, instead of a regular citizen?
It's not that easy, he'd protested. Only those who make a significant contribution to the survival of the ashram can be nominated to the council. Nela is well on her way to that. It doesn't mean I think non-architects any less.
I think it does, she said quietly. Her heart felt heavy. Now, after all the arguments, they had finally come to it. You've changed since you became a senior architect, Iravan, since you became a part of the council, with all its secrets and rationales above the rest of us. You don't like to admit it, but now I embarrass you. You look down on me and the rest of us who can't traject. Maybe you always have. Our stories, a lack of history, our very lives in this architect's world does mean nothing to you. Perhaps you don't even think anything is wrong with the way our civilization exists. And I'm not about to make a child until you figure out what's right.
Iravan's eyes glittered. His handsome face darkened in dawning outrage. He'd stood up then, snatched his clothes, and walked away. With the earthrage announced hours later, she hadn't seen him since. Daria was still throwing half-concerned, half-irritated glances toward her. Ahilya sighed, reached for her sister's hand, and squeezed. Daria's lips twitched. She squeezed back. In front of them, the Rudra tree began to vibrate. The crowd oohed and awed. Several people clapped and cheered. A large ring-shaped platform, the architect's disc, became visible on the tree's topmost stories. Atop it, the shapes of 100 glowing maze architects grew distinct, revealing the source of the ethereal blue-green light. Daria gripped Ahilya's hand in excitement. Somewhere on the disc, along with the other two senior architects of Nakshar, Iravan and Baravi orchestrated the maze architects. Ahilya tried not to look too closely. With the appearance of the disc, the temple became denser. The gallery Ahilya was on crept closer to the Rudra tree. The city that had spanned acres in the sky during an earthrage shrank, became smaller, stronger. Pressure built in her ears, but before it could hurt, she inhaled and worked her jaw. The sharp scent of heel branch entered her lungs. Green tendrils sprouted from the woody railing and wove themselves over and under her hands. Roots twined between her legs, arms, and waist, over to her neck, holding her steady. Ahilya closed her eyes, imagining what Nakshar must look like from the outside, an oblong tangle of roots, leaves, and branches, tied and tightened in 100 different layers, plummeting toward the jungle below. She could almost feel its controlled hurtle, the snap and break of the trees as it crashed through the jungle like a comet. She breathed deeply, fighting the sense of overwhelming vertigo and turbulence. The will of the city grew inside her, all the citizens, attuning their consciousness to keep everyone safe. And then, stillness. The city hovered briefly. A moment of weightlessness. Exhalation. Nakshar dropped the last few feet gently, and Ahilya felt the thud. She opened her eyes. Dim green light burst through the foliage as the bark carapace gave way to roots and leaves again. Nakshar began expanding, grounding, re-knitting itself. Vines and shoots untangled, stretching and integrating with the city's new design. Ahilya inhaled deeply, relieved despite herself, as all the vines holding her dissolved back into the railing.
The Rudra tree in the center shot up, tall and slender now. The temple floor softened into a grassy courtyard with rock pools tinkling between bark benches. Chatting, smiling maize architects in their embroidered brown kurtas and trousers poured out of the architect's disc, shucking off their translucent robes, relief evident on their faces. Only a few maize architects remained on the disc as it soared toward the canopy, high enough so even the blue-green light of trajection was no longer visible. Ahilya opened her mouth to speak, but she was alone on the wide gallery. Along with Vihanen, Renya, and the rest, Tharia had already started down the winding ramp that now connected the gallery to the temple's new courtyard, her chair dissolving into the ground. An excited babble of conversation arose, then faded, as citizens created pathways beyond the bark walls to leave the temple. Now that they'd landed, the council had evidently allowed the plants to respond to everyone again. Ahilya's neck prickled. She turned and dipped her chin. There, in the courtyard, looking up at her, stood her husband. Her eyes met Aravan's over the distance. He'd divested himself of his translucent robe, but the rest of his senior architect uniform, a white, shin-length kurta over tapered white trousers, shone amongst the brown of other ordinary maize architects. His sleeves were rolled back, a dozen Rudra bead bracelets covering both wrists. She knew there were more beads underneath his clothes, necklaces and armbands, far more than other architects, each bead holding special permissions. Robin's skin was too dark to tell any patterns from afar, but there was no concealing the blue-green light that pulsed on his sinewy arms and stony face. His entire body seemed bathed in light from within. Ahilya stared at him, the way he held himself, tall and proud, his thick salt and pepper hair tangled, longer and grayer than it had been before, his jaw tightening the way it did when he was trying to control himself. Her husband's almost black eyes glittered back at her. He made no move to climb the ramp. They stood for a long moment, staring at each other. Ahilya's chest tightened. She couldn't get a full breath. A cough sounded behind her.
Dhruv and Om have left for the meeting point, Nayla said. Did you want to? I can tell them to wait if you want to visit.
No. Ahilya broke the gaze first. She turned to the junior architect. Let's go.
3. Iravan. In the usual manner of trajection, Iravan's vision was split into two. In the first, he stood in the growing courtyard, clenching and unclenching his jaw, staring after his wife as she walked away from him. His fingers twitched. His feet stirred. He breathed erratically, wanting to follow her, forgive her, submit to her. Iravan forced himself to stillness. He had searched for her from the architect's disc. The instant the ashram had landed, he'd leapt off the disc and hurried to where the junior architect had brought her. Seeing Ahilya had frozen him in his tracks. She was so beautiful, tendrils of hair escaping her knot, those big eyes glittering with fierce intelligence. He'd waited for a sign, a lift of her lips, a softening of her gaze, anything. He'd waited for her to take a step. And she'd walked away. His heart thudded in his chest, longing warred with rage and regret. The courtyard filled with the welcoming families of other architects. Children sprinted past clustering adults to jump into their parents' waiting arms. Lovers spotted each other, faces breaking out into smiles. Others embraced and kissed, voices laced with relief. Within his first vision, Iravan stood silent and alone. Within his second vision, he existed as a dust mote suspended in an infinite universe. Golden lights gleamed in every direction, endless and breathtaking. The universe was the moment, a motionless reality reflecting the consciousness of the plants that comprised the building blocks of Nuxture. Each frozen star in the moment was a plant's possible state of being. Infinite such states existed for every plant. Yet, Iravan knew each one as well as he knew himself. Within this star, the water lily existed as a fully ripened bloom, frozen forever. In a star farther away, the ironwood was suspended in eternal decay. Birth through death, countless potentials twinkled. Iravan drifted through the moment, surrounded by life. Nearly 50 dust motes inhabited the universe with him, each an architect fulfilling their duty to stabilize Nuxture. As Iravan watched, some of the dust motes generated constellation lines and wove between the stars. The lines intersected and locked, connecting different stars. Nuxture's architecture unfolded around him in a complex maze. Iravan smiled. This was something that non-architects could never understand. Nuxture's living architecture was more than just a maze of plants. It was the intersection of lives, of promises, of intent. It was elegance and beauty and harmony. Here was the temple, shaped like a warren of corridors. Further ahead grew the library, its loops indicating private alcoves. Iravan meandered through the lines of the solar lab. He drifted beyond the spaces of the infirmary. He swooped over bridge renditions, ducked under gazebo arches, slid over shapes of playgrounds. In his second vision, there was peace. Peace and belonging. In his first vision, he stood in the temple courtyard, staring at where Ahilya had disappeared. Iravan, a woman's musical voice called out. Your landing design was successful. You can leave the moment now. The architects on the disc know what to do. Parvi strode toward him, still enveloped in her translucent robe, though like the other architects assembled in the courtyard, her skin no longer glowed with the light of trajection. Her eyes were narrowed in displeasure. Off-duty architects hurriedly made way for her. The senior architect stopped right in front of him and crossed her arms. A slim woman with dark chin-length hair and rosy brown skin, Padavi was short, reaching only to Iravan's chest. Somehow, that didn't deter her from looming over him. Closer, the wrinkles on her face were more pronounced, the shadows dark and heavy under the eyes. He probably looked much the same. Did you hear me? She said. You can stop now. Iravan trajected. As a dust mote, he sailed over the stars until he reached Nuxture's perimeter. The outer maze, where the ashram bordered the jungle, was a tangle of disconnected lines. Iravan watched a dozen dust motes hover there. The maze architects on duty, currently trajecting from the architect's disc. The motes generated fresh constellation lines, connecting disparate stars, but the lines shattered before they could snap together in place. Iravan frowned. He recognized the dust motes, Megha and Gaurav and Kriya among them. His superior skill and ascension to the council had created a natural distance between him and them, but they had once been nominated to the same council seat he now occupied. each was a competent maze architect, then why were their constellation lines shattering? The lull in an earthrage and the subsequent landing should have made trajection easier. He leapt into the fray, generating his own constellation lines, exerting the force of his desire to influence the plants of the ashram. Iravan connected the star containing the briar bush, looped around the redwood, and fastened his lines to 100 other stars in a complex, net-shaped pattern. A dozen dust motes reached toward him, extending their own simpler lines. His constellation lines vibrated almost to their breaking point, fighting him, denying his will. Iravan focused his entire being into the action. He spun and wove between the motes, twisting and turning. The outline he'd created snapped into place. Several thousand stars connected. Another part of the maze unfolded and settled. The dust motes soared, cheer and gratitude in their zipping streaks. Iravan grinned. Here was a place where he was needed, where he was necessary. His breathing eased. He left the hovering motes and began to drift within the moment again. In the temple courtyard, Parvi drummed her foot. "You're not listening to me," she said. "Trajection was hard this time, Pa," Iravan said. "Don't tell me you didn't feel it. The disc needs all the help it can get." "Your landing design was new. A period of adjustment for the maze architects is expected." "My landing design was simple, and still our constellation lines kept crumbling. That wasn't because the maze architects weren't familiar with the design."
"Maybe everyone is just exhausted because of the terribly long earthrage we've had," she said.
Iravan gave her a level look. Both knew the length of an earthrage didn't matter. The rationale behind strict shift duty was for an architect to never overextend themselves. It was so the ashram could sustain flight forever. The lull was a mere opportunity for maze architects to traject with ease. During lulls, all plants of Nuxure became easier to traject, the closer they were to the jungle. It was why the council had decided to land.
"It wasn't exhaustion," he said flatly. "I've watched the maze architects since the time the earthrage was announced. Viana made so many mistakes I had to send her back to the academy. Karan struggled with basic patterns to the point of tears. It's a sign. The plants. They aren't responding to us as they once did. Trajection is getting harder. The disc needs my help."
He paused within his second vision. He had been patrolling the outer maze, assisting the maze architects. But there, behind the glow of a gigantic star, hovered something. He'd noticed it before, through all the months of living in the temple, hidden behind his every trajection. At first, he'd thought it a dust mote, just another architect whom he didn't know well enough to recognize in the moment. Yet unlike other motes, the particle didn't spin around the stars. No constellation lines were attached to it. Instead, it undulated like mercury, silvery and molten, throbbing like a heart. Iravan approached it. The particle pulsed, approaching closer. He stopped. The particle stopped. He darted to the left, and it darted, mirroring him.
"What are you?"
he thought, startled. Parvi shifted her feet.
"Iravan, are you saying you didn't leave the temple at all during the flight?"
He barely heard her. Slowly, very carefully, he drew closer. The particle lingered, pulsing. He saw himself in it, although it was not his face he saw, not within the moment. Instead, he perceived his
echo, like he had fallen into a mirror to see his own eye reflected 100 times over, until any image became meaningless. It felt like a resonance, he thought. He could find no other term for it. Bah, he said in a low voice. There's something in the moment, something strange. She uncrossed her arms and tapped at one of her Rudra bracelets. A hologram arose over her wrist, Iravan's picture next to a roster of names. It hung there for an instant before it collapsed. Padavi dropped her hand. I see you signed up for watch post duty, she said. Wasn't it Chaya's turn? He waved a hand to shush her. The resonance swayed in front of him, silvery, liquid. He retreated, and the resonance retreated. He floated back another step, and the resonance did the same. Then, in rapid, blinking flashes that made Iravan think of a wicked grin, the resonance spun and darted away, shooting through the universe. Bloody rages, he thought. Iravan dashed through the moment, trying to keep his sight on the undulating particle. They whirled through the lights, zooming past constellation lines, startling dust motes. He sped past an architect, felt their indignation. He attempted to cut the resonance off, but the particle stopped short and streaked back the way it had come. Iravan cursed again and wheeled around, swooping over a star, leaping past long lines of the maze. There was a familiarity in the particle's movements, like he ought to know what it would do next. He rounded a golden star and pulled up in front of the resonance. It drew up, alarmed and amused. Huh, Iravan thought. He hovered, waiting to see what it would do next. Padavi pressed a hand to his shoulder. Tell me, when was the last time you saw Ahilya? The resonance attacked. Iravan had a horrified glimpse of fury rushing over its mirrored surface before the particle collided into him. The stars of the moment winked out. He was tumbling through blackness. He was falling endlessly. In the temple courtyard, Iravan stumbled into Padavi, his mouth dropping open. The universe wiped out, all stars gone, just the sensation of plummeting down a black hole. He opened and closed his mouth, trying to make words, staring at Padavi. His stomach lurched, and he leaned over, heaving. What's wrong? She said at once. Did your two visions merge? She gripped his shoulders, holding him up. He choked, shaking his head. Shooting a glance around them, Padavi steered him away from the bustle of the courtyard and closer to the base of the Rudra tree, where there were no other architects. In his second vision, Iravan jerked and came to a standstill within an infinite, velvety black hole. He spun around in tight, panicked circles, scanning for a light. Any light, hunting for a dust mote, a star, the resonance, anything. The resonance slammed into him. With shocking pain, Iravan lurched back into the moment. Stars twinkled again, familiar and comforting. Nuxure's maze reappeared, blue-green constellation lines crisscrossing. The floating sensation that always accompanied Iravan on entering the universe returned. But the resonance flickered in front of his dust mote, still, as though it had not just attacked him. Innocence reverberated in its silvery flaps. Iravan darted away from it so fast that he bounced into the closest star, lush green paddy, before he dashed back out to hover in the moment. He spun around, lights whirling through his second vision, but the resonance had disappeared. Padavi was still looking at him with concern, her hands bracing him against the Rudra tree's broad trunk.
Iravan straightened, sweating. He nodded his thanks, and Paravi dropped her arms. She took a step back. "What happened to you?" she repeated quietly. "Did your visions merge?" "No," his voice came out cracked. "Not that, something else." As horrifying as the experience of tumbling down that black hole had been, at least Iravan had remained himself. If his two visions had merged, he would have lost himself within a trajected upon star, lost himself in a frozen moment of a plant's consciousness. He'd have no knowledge of a way out, no memory of who he was. Once two visions merged, it was nearly impossible to reverse them. Only very skilled architects could lurch themselves back from it.
"Then what?"
Padavi persisted. I don't know." His voice was still ragged. "There was this thing, the shape. No, not a shape, like a rhythm, an interference within the moment, a kind of resonance." Padavi's frown deepened. Her hands opened and closed like a dreadbud bloom. The panic of the experience rolled through Iravan in waves. Within the moment, he dove toward the star belonging to a budding jasmine. He tied the star to itself in a simple trajection, then flew to the homes with a Nuxer's architecture and into his own home. There, he secured the constellation line to the lush Ixora bush. The constellation lines glittered in the moment and settled. A measure of control returned to him. He coughed, steadying his voice. "Yes, a resonance. An interference, it. He rubbed a hand on his face, feeling his bristles. "Bah, I think it knocked me out of the moment." Padavi glanced around the courtyard, but Iravan had kept his voice low, and the nearest architects were several feet away.
"That's not possible."
"I know what I felt."
"Iravan, you're exhausted. Do I need to explain what happens when an architect is exhausted?"
"Don't patronize me, Padavi. I'm not your apprentice anymore. I'm a senior architect in my own right. I know what exhaustion in the moment feels like. And this wasn't it." She stared at him. Iravan rolled his shoulders and leaned his head back on the tree. He closed his eyes, breathing deeply. Exhausted architects could lose their connection with the moment, sometimes unable to enter it at all. Iravan had no such difficulty. He hovered in his home, between gigantic stars, then flew back out to where May's architects placed finishing touches to other structures. Orchards bloomed. Boulevards widened. With the familiarity, Iravan's heartbeat eased. When he opened his eyes, Padavi was still watching him. He spoke before she could.
"If this is interfering with trajection, then it could cause critical failure. We could plummet into the earthrage mid-flight next time."
Padavi sighed.
"You need to let the architects on the disc take care of the maze. You need to rest. Spend time with your wife."
Iravan shook his head. He pushed past her, back into the courtyard. The temple was starting to resemble an expansive cavern. The architects had flattened the ellipsoid of the landing architecture almost completely. Evening sunshine fell in thin shafts through fissures in a high, root-encrusted ceiling. Water rippled from rock pools, adding its tinkle to the echoes bounding off the hardened walls. Off-duty architects made way for him, giving him a wide berth. Iravan tried to wipe the scowl off his face. Padavi kept pace with him.
"Why did you sign up for watchpost duty?"
He grunted.
"Do I need to explain how the watchpost works? I signed up because a senior architect is supposed to perform the duty."
"Don't give me that," she snapped. It's Jaya's turn. Why did you switch it?
She's pregnant. I volunteered.
How chivalrous. When was the last time you saw Ahilya?
Bharavi was one of the few people in the ashram who could question him on his marriage, but Iravan's eyes narrowed in displeasure nevertheless. Why do you ask?
She waved a hand at the temple courtyard. Ahilya's not here, is she? Every other disc architect's family has come to greet them.
We've landed, haven't we? I'm sure all I will do this lull is see her.
I know the number of shifts you took this time. Too many. Far too many.
Yes, well, with so many architects struggling with basic trajection, it was the right thing to do.
It's not healthy, Iravan. It's not safe.
Iravan held up a hand. You can excoriate me further about my choices, Pa, or you can go to your wife. Thalia is waiting.
He gestured past the shifting bodies in the crowd.
Thalia was carefully climbing down the last foot of the ramp, her baby cradled in her arms, Kush by her side. Padavi's face softened. Perhaps knowing Iravan would follow, she began to weave through the clusters of people without another word. Iravan trailed more slowly. Seeing Thalia with her children made his chest spasm in sudden longing. A picture blinked at him, something he had created in his mind long before, of a boy and a girl, with his dark skin and Ahilya's fierce, magnetic eyes. He forced the image away. Bharavi reached her family, kissed Thalia, then gathered Earth into her arms. She murmured something to Kush that made the boy giggle. Thalia watched her fondly, then turned to Iravan. Her expression changed to annoyance, though he could tell it was not for him.
Ahilya, she began.
I saw her, he said shortly.
Thalia shrugged, an uncomfortable gesture. I'm sorry. You know how willful she can get. She was prattling about her experiment and how she really had to leave.
Her expedition, he corrected, at the same time as Padavi said.
Leave for where?
Thalia bit her lip. The jungle, Iravan said. For her archaeological study. She's studying the Yakshas.
I thought she'd give it up,
Thalia said, grimacing.
That she'd grow out of it. It's like she's going out of her way to convince herself that her research will give her a shot at the council as though she were an architect herself. She can't see how misguided she is. And Regis forbid you try to talk to her about it. Doesn't she see how it's affecting, well, you two?
Thalia shook her head in exasperation. Iravan averted his gaze. Thalia was saying aloud what others in his company only dared to whisper. His demeanor didn't allow for more insult to Ahilya than that, or for such familiarity towards his marriage. But suddenly he couldn't bring himself to disagree with Thalia, let alone challenge her. By its very nature, Ahilya's ambition to the council was flawed. These jungle expeditions were useless. It was why the rest of the council had dithered on giving her permission to go at all, unwilling to raise false hopes. In the end, Iravan had made the decision, accepting her request, but he had done it for her. Not her expedition. Had he truly bought into believing architects were better than non-architects? Thalia studied Iravan for a long moment, waiting for a response. When he said nothing, she glanced at Padavi.
Shall we go, my love? A minute, if you don't mind, dear, Padavi replied.
She handed Earth back to her wife, and Thalia walked away a few paces, beckoning to Kush. Padavi grabbed Iravan's arm and pulled him away from the nearest architects, back into the recesses of the Rudra tree. I notice you didn't defend Ahilya. She's a grown woman. She's making her choices. She doesn't need me to defend her from her sister, of all people.
You fought with her, didn't you? That's what this is about.
Iravan jerked his arm away. She fought with me, and I'm not going to apologize if that's what you're going to say next. I didn't do anything wrong.
Don't be childish. You know you need to fix it.
I did. I gave her the council's permission to go. I even gave her a junior architect, so she has someone to direct the jungle for her.
That's hardly the same as making things right, Iravan.
What else do you want me to do, Bharavi? Force my presence on her? She had a chance to come visit. She was there, standing right next to Thorny. Isn't it clear? She doesn't want to see me.
You had a chance to go to her too. Did you? Even once during the 7-month flight?
Iravan glanced away from her knowing gaze. I was angry.
What could she have done to make you this angry?
He didn't answer. Each time he had thought to leave the temple, each time he had connected his citizen ring to reply to Ahilya's message, broken images from their last encounter had reignited his cold fury. Ahilya accusing him of secrets. Ahilya questioning his intent for fatherhood. Ahilya never understanding what the pressures of being a senior architect were. She had been right to fear the change his promotion had brought. He had changed, but it hadn't been wrong, had it? It had been necessary. He'd grown. He'd evolved. He'd kept the difficult secrets of his position, alone, without her support. Pranshu read his silence correctly.
She didn't do anything. Rage is 7 months, Iravan. You know she can't come to the temple during a flight, not without permission. It was your move to make. What kind of a sign are you sending her by not going to her at all?
Let it go, Parvi, he growled. This has always been our dynamic. Ahilya and I aren't like you and Thorny. We don't need to talk to each other every hour of every day.
Are you serious? The subtleties of your marriage don't concern me, but something is wrong, so don't you dare try that. If you haven't seen Ahilya at all, maybe we need to begin vigilance again.
Iravan scowled. Senior architects were not above the rules that May's architects obeyed, but both Iravan and Parvi had lapsed into ignoring the vigilance they usually kept over each other's material bonds. For 7 months, Iravan had logged his whereabouts in the most general terms, and Parvi had attested it without looking too closely, just like he had attested hers, a sign of trust in each other and their positions. But as she crossed her arms over her chest now, her stance unmoving, he knew she was not joking about making him account for his every step again as though he were a maze architect. He forced his features into calm. It's not that serious. You're reading too much.
Am I? Parvi said. I don't think so. I'm seeing a pattern. You've been in the temple all during the earthrage. You signed up for extra watch post duty. You're clearly avoiding your wife. And even though you're not on the disc anymore, you are still trajecting.
Iravan glanced at his arms. His skin gleamed as vines grew on it in a simple, twinning parallax. He had been interlocking more jasmine within his home for Ahilya, he thought pathetically, just as he had in the entryway to the temple, for all the good it had done. But at Bharavi's words, Iravan collapsed the constellation lines and stopped trajecting. The blue-green tattoos on his arms receded.
Very good, Parvi said. Now, leave the moment.
Iravan drew himself up to his full height. You can't order me about, Pa.
Consider it a professional suggestion, then. Leave the moment.
Her voice brooked no argument. Equals though they were now, old habits died hard.
Iravan let his second vision collapse. The blue-green glow under his skin disappeared. He blinked, now fully in the bustling courtyard. The floating sensation in his belly vanished as soon as he retreated from the moment, and sudden exhaustion crashed into him, filling his limbs with dead weight. "If I were running risks," Padavi said in a hard voice, "I wouldn't do it in the temple, where the rest of the council is probably watching."
"What are you implying?"
"Would you like me to spell it out?" She closed the distance between them and poked a finger into his chest, stabbing him with every sentence. "It's dangerous for an architect to traject without a break, lest they lose touch with the material world. If they lose touch with the material world, they lose control over themselves. If they lose control over themselves, they begin to destroy architecture in the moment instead of building it. They become an ecstatic."
I'm not becoming.
"If the council suspects an architect of ecstasy," she went on, speaking over him, "it can demand they take an exam."
"That won't."
"If an architect fails the exam," Parvi continued, her words a low snarl, her finger pressing his rudra beads into his chest over his kurta, "they are excised."
The word hung between them, dark, dangerous, malevolent. Excision. Free from the focus of projecting, a picture conjured itself in Iravan's mind of architects he had seen excised. Their grief had different expressions, but all of them had one thing in common. They had been cut away from their trajection. It was the ultimate punishment, reserved for ecstatic architects.
"Are you threatening me?" he said, his voice cold.
"I'm warning you."
"No, you're grasping at weeds. Last I checked, I was part of the council, a senior architect, and a senior architect can traject whenever they want."
"A senior architect knows the limits of trajection. A senior architect understands why a healthy family life is an indicator of tight material bonds. A senior architect is smarter. Or have you so quickly forgotten Manav?"
Manav had been a senior architect and counselor not 5 years earlier. Iravan had excised him personally, and Manav's position had lain vacant ever since. Iravan's babbling about the resonance, his feud with Ahilya, his concern for the maze architects, all took on a darker note. He stared at Padavi, and she stared back, relentless, his friend, his confidant, and, if he were ever so wretched, his executioner. She was too damned watchful for his own good.
"Are these lessons you need to relearn?" she said. "Because I could ask the rest of the council to vote on having you tested for ecstasy right now. Is that what you want, Iravan?"
"No," he said. "No, I don't."
Padavi's hand pressed into his arm again, the grip hard. "If I'm noticing these patterns, others are too. My responsibility is clear. Please don't give me a reason to tell them what I've observed. Whatever is going on with you and Ahilya, fix it."
With a final cautionary glance, she swung around and joined her family. Two paths opened in Iravan's mind between his brows, one toward Ahilya and the other toward his own intuition. The call of the second path was almost too seductive to ignore, tempting him to return to the moment, to seek the mysterious resonance, solve it. Yet he could not bring himself to disregard a direct instruction from Padavi.
She had been his mentor. She had nominated him into the council. She was his most vocal supporter.
Iravan thought of how Ahilya had walked away from him. He remembered how he had left her. The anger, the hurt, the outraged righteousness. They reverberated through him again, warring with the memory of the resonance.
Is that what you want, Iravan? With a sigh, he turned his back to the architect's disc and approached a wall.
The philodendron opened, reacting to his desire. Clenching his jaw, Iravan guided the plant to weave him the fastest way to the outer maze and to his wife.
4. Ahilya. The others were already waiting by the time Ahilya and Nela arrived at the outer maze. The junior architect had trajected a path directly from the temple, yet the two had needed to stop for Nela to switch her uniform for attire more suitable to the jungle. She wore a shorter kurta now, much like Ahilya's own, and her long wavy hair was tied into a sensible knot. They hurried into the outer maze together, toward Dhruv and Om, pushing past thick brambles. What had earlier been a terrace of Nakshar now resembled a shady copse, complete with towering trees and soft, cushiony moss. Evening sunlight fell in translucent shafts of green. From high in the branches, the birds of the city twittered and squawked. It might have been peaceful, but Ahilya froze in her tracks, her heart throbbing in her throat, startled at its familiarity. The clearing resembled far too much the very grove she and Iravan had fought in all those months before. For an instant, she remembered the jasmine curtain at the temple's entrance, the way he had stared at her, so cold and unyielding. Had he built the outer maze? It would be so like him, this wordless sign, this dark apology. Ahilya's breath grew quick and uneasy, as though she had unexpectedly come face to face with him. Guilt weighed her body down. Material bonds were crucial to an architect's trajectory, and a healthy marriage was a visible sign of those bonds. Ahilya had walked away from Iravan knowing that. It was an action born out of cold fury, but in her mind's eye, she could still see him snatch his clothes and leave after their argument. He'd punished her with silence for so long. What was her small rebellion compared to his? They went around in circles, each of them furious with the other. She couldn't remember anymore if things had always been this way. Her stomach churned in confusion and anger.
Ahilya, Dhruv called out, breaking into her thoughts. Over here.
She blinked and looked away from the thicket toward him. Tall and lanky, with wire-thin spectacles, Dhruv appeared the consummate sungeoneer. His yellow-striped kurta gleamed in the last shafts of sunlight. He pointed at the shiny devices in the bag by his feet. Ahilya swallowed and approached him. Nela had already joined the group, turning this way and that, adjusting the harness Dhruv placed over her, but the last member of the expedition stood leaning against a tree, watching the proceedings with casual amusement, his own harness loose and hanging off him.
Om needs help, Dhruv said. See to him, please, while I finish with the junior architect.
Ahilya took a deep, shaky breath. The familiarity of the copse, the memory of her fight with Iravan, the growing twilight, all of it conspired to shape her misgivings. But she couldn't afford to be distracted. The expedition was what mattered now. She had waited too long, fought too hard. She nodded at Dhruv and forced herself back to this thicket, to focus on seeing it for what it was, not what it reminded her of. Next to the sungeoneer, Om greeted her approach with a wicked smile. Of a height with Ahilya and only as old as Nela, Om spread his arms wide
as though inviting Ahilya to embrace him. He still wore his nurse's scrubs from the infirmary, but his braided curls were tied in a concession to the expedition. As Ahilya reached for his harness, his grin grew wider, too familiar to be respectful. Ahilya bit back the creeping humiliation of her circumstance and returned a tight smile. She couldn't fool herself. Ohm's eagerness with the expedition had more to do with his infatuation with her than her research. But in time, he would become her first true apprentice, Nakshar's second archaeologist. Her work would continue beyond her lifetime. She ought to be grateful the council had allowed him to accompany her at all. Ohm dropped his arms as she tightened the harness around him. His fingers brushed against her satchel. Before Ahilya could react, he pulled out her solar note, beginning to swipe through it. Irritation bubbled within her, but she took a deep breath, calming herself. She had meant to give Ohm the tablet in any case within the jungle. His entire job in this excursion was to sketch the elephant yaksha they were tracking. Out of the corner of her eyes, she saw the images on the glassy screen flicker, pictures she'd drawn herself on previous expeditions. The gorilla yaksha's massive shoulders, the wolf yaksha's menacing gaze, the tiger yaksha lapping water from a pond. "Are you ready?" she asked, buckling the straps on his shoulders tighter. "It ought to be exciting."
"I've never seen one before," Ohm said by way of reply.
"Few people have," Ahilya murmured. Yakshas had been a part of the world almost as long as humans, yet a regular citizen learned little about the creatures. All records glossed over the yakshas, mentioning them in happenstance, typical of architect histories that focused only on flight and matters of architect welfare. Even people who couldn't traject were rarely mentioned, except as bystanders, and then only to indicate how architects were superior in comparison. She gestured for Ohm to turn so she could adjust the clasps on the front. He obeyed, his brows slightly furrowed. This close, she could feel his barely contained nervousness hidden behind the bravado of youth, the twitch by his eyes, the fast breathing, the beads of sweat.
"It's all right to be scared, you know," she said softly.
"It can be a disorienting experience."
"I'm not scared," he said at once, stiffening.
Then, betraying his words, he added,
"So these yakshas, they're huge, aren't they? You ever seen a small one?"
"No, they're always gigantic. The last time I saw the elephant yaksha, it was 20 feet tall. The architects think that's how these creatures survive the earthrages, but of course there's more there than that."
"My fathers said that a bird yaksha nearly attacked the ashram when they were younger."
"Not attack," Ahilya said, shaking her head. "Collided. I remember when that happened. The architects had to change the flight path of the city abruptly, and Nakshar ended up avoiding the collision. But it happened because these creatures don't notice us at all, not even our cities. Whatever plane of existence they are on, we have no part in it. In and of themselves, they're truly passive." Ohm bit his lip, nodding slowly.
"Don't worry," she said, her voice gentle. "I'll keep you safe." "Maybe I'll keep you safe," he said, straightening.
He winked at her, rolled his shoulders back, and returned his attention to the solar note. Ahilya didn't attempt any more placation. Ohm had much to learn about personal boundaries, but she couldn't deny his knack for stumbling into practicalities. The only reason the council entertained her excursions was because she had convinced them of the benefits long before. With her data, they could avoid crashing into the aerial incarnations of the yakshas. They could judge changes in jungle plants after an earthrage. They could discover the best places to land during a lull.
Ahilya had urged Nakshar's counsel time and again to use her research for these very matters. But if their response to her latest requests was any indication, most of her reports were languishing in some unseen part of their communiques. They were losing patience with these trips to the jungle, she knew. This time, it was a last-minute concession. Next time, they might not allow her out of Nakshar at all. The urgency grew within her to leave the city already, to dawdle no longer. Her fingers worked faster, securing one clasp after another.
It says here you didn't really expect these expeditions to work,
Om murmured. Ahilya crouched and adjusted the brace along his waist. There's always an element of uncertainty to these things.
But this seems more than that, he said. It says here you thought the expedition needed luck, that,
and he quoted,
archaeology is a joke. Until I present an alternative, everyone will be content to believe the architect's inadequate explanations.
Their explanations are inadequate. The Yakshas have adapted to the jungle somehow, beyond what the architects say. If we find out how, then our civilization will no longer need to fly. Our dependence on the architects could end. Om paused, a nervous laugh escaping him.
You really don't like the architects, do you?
Ahilya glanced at him, meeting his uncertain gaze. Architects are necessary, she replied carefully. I'd be foolish to deny that. We need them in the city, and I need them in the jungle. Who else would traject a path outside?
But what you wrote here,
he persisted in a low voice.
What did you mean?
I only meant there might be other ways to survive, Om.
Better ways. And if you and I find them, then maybe we could change something.
That's not our problem, though. Survival is the council's concern. So engineers and architects, they can worry about that.
We're part of the city, too. Isn't it our concern as well? If we found something useful to contribute to survival, maybe one day an ordinary citizen like us could get a seat on the council.
But people like us, we don't know anything about flight and architecture.
If we offered another solution, maybe we wouldn't need to.
But if architects bothered you so much,
Om said, his voice serious,
why did you marry one?
The question was so innocent, so obvious, that Ahilya recoiled, momentarily stunned. She opened and closed her mouth, sudden hot tears burning the back of her eyes. Because Iravan is different, she thought, but couldn't bring herself to utter the words. Iravan had been different once, a long time before. He'd been passionate about changing the old ways of the council. Arrived from Yikshar at Nakshar, he had been willing to look at her and the world differently. But his promotion had changed him so much. Her throat tightened. Blood heated her face. In her mind's eye, she watched him walk away from her again. Ahilya stepped back from Om, tugging her solar note back from his hands. I think we're done here, she said quietly. Your harness is ready. She turned away from Om's startled eyes and toward Dhruv. Are you finished? The Yaksha could move away any minute.
Not quite, Dhruv answered. There are devices for both of you in here.
He nudged the bag by his feet, and Ahilya strode toward it, Om trailing her, an abashed look on his face. The long days of loneliness following Ravan's silence had returned to her the minute Om had asked his question. Her husband flickered in her mind, his face darkening in outrage as she questioned his integrity, precipitated his anger. But Ahilya pushed the image away, violently, and focused on the devices that glittered in the bag. Her hand encountered a diamond-shaped half-locket dangling from a glassy chain. Like most sun engineering equipment, the locket was made of resilient bark and thin optical fibers connecting the circuitry inside. A low chiming sound emerged from it, muffled by Ahilya's fingers as she withdrew it. She looked up, her eyebrows raised. The last time she'd used this tracker locket, it had been silent.
"I've made a few adjustments," Dhruv said, understanding her unspoken question. "The ringing will become faster the closer you get to the Yaksha. It should help navigate your path."
"Thank you," she said, wearing the necklace. The locket was heavy at her throat, its steady beat at odds with her racing pulse. Somewhere out in the jungle, the transmitter that formed the other half of the tracker waited for her. Dhruv nodded, his eyes solemn behind his glasses. Some of Ahilya's tension receded with his steadying presence. In all of the city, the Sungeneer alone remained her true companion. They had grown up together, discussing Nakshar's politics, angry and passionate, wanting to do something. Their choices had taken them in different directions, Dhruv toward the solar lab and her to archaeology, but their separate careers had only drawn them closer. She and Dhruv had prepared for the nomination together, trying out their theories for survival, learning and quizzing each other about Nakshar's administration, analyzing and dissecting their competitors' theses. It was Dhruv who had come to her mere days earlier, babbling about how one of the trackers had transmitted a signal to his lab. Ahilya's mind had been on Iravan, but Dhruv had almost dragged her to the library's leafy walls.
"You don't have much time," he'd said. "You need to get your crew together."
"How can there be a signal at all?" she'd asked, unable to get her hopes up. "I thought all Sungeneering equipment ran on trajection." Dhruv had nodded, an excited smile splitting his face.
"Yes, yes, the tracker can only recharge if it's around a trajecting architect. But don't you see? Nakshar happens to be in its range for the first time during landing. All the trajection from the city must have kick-started the transmitter. You can study the same Yaksha you did before."
"But
go! I can explain all this later."
Ahilya hadn't asked any more questions. Dhruv had pushed her toward the walls, and she'd created paths, first to the academy to request an architect, and then to Ohm to prepare for an expedition. She watched him now as he bent next to her to withdraw more pieces of equipment identical to the ones she had in her satchel.
"You need to bring back every piece," he said severely as he handed those to Ohm one by one. "Every piece. They're very expensive, and I will hold you personally accountable for their care."
"Why don't you just come with us?"
Ohm muttered, turning the devices in his hands.
"Out in the jungle? No, thank you. I'm not designed to go outside a city, and neither is this equipment. All of this runs on trajection, so don't stray too far from Nela. She's your only source of energy out there."
"Don't stray too far from Nela, regardless,"
Nela urged, standing next to them.
"The jungle is unpredictable, and trajection, it's a bit, there's something about it. Just stay close."
Ohm frowned. In a world destroyed constantly and unpredictably by earthrages, where the only certainty was trajection, the architect's words didn't inspire any confidence. Ahilya spoke before he could raise any objections.
"We'll be fine, won't we, Ohm?"
A startled glance passed over Ohm, perhaps at the unexpected warmth in her voice. He returned her smile, flicked a loose braided curl behind him, and stood up straighter.
"Right," Dhruv said briskly. "Inspect your equipment, both of you, and then double-check each other's gear. Ahilya, with me, please, while I do the same for you. These should be your final verifications."
Ohm and Nela murmured, each of them asking the other to turn first. Ahilya followed Dhruv to the other side of the kopse reluctantly. She knew why he had pulled her out of earshot, but time was running out. She'd tagged the elephant Yaksha nearly 5 years before, yet for the first time in her life, she'd see the same creature more than once. The expedition could vindicate all her previous forays into the jungle. It could convince the council to take her seriously. It could even provide hard evidence for survival on land, something that could directly contribute to being nominated to the council. Based on what she found, today's expedition would either clear her path forever or dash all her expectations to the ground. She followed the Sungeneer, her mind on the comparisons she could make to her baseline readings. Zurv stopped and his voice dropped. "All right," he said, his businesslike manner vanishing now that they were.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.